In this video, we continue to develop our algebra of differentiation by finding out what happens if we take the derivative of a quotient of two functions. So I gave this thing a name, I called it capital Q for quotient, and it's defined as f of x over g of x. And the whole goal here is to figure out, can we write the derivative of this thing in terms of the derivatives of the individual functions f and g? And like any proof about differentiation, we have to go back to the definition of the derivative. So q prime of x is the limit as h goes to 0 of q of x plus h minus q of x, all divided by h. And I'll post a link at the top to the video where this was first derived. So to start things out here, we have to evaluate q at x plus h. That just means replacing the x's with x plus h's. And then we have to evaluate q at x, which is just the original expression here, f of x over g of x. So when I evaluate q at x plus h, I just get f of x plus h over g of x plus h. And again, q of x is just our original function, f of x over g of x. And then we divide the whole thing by h. So we end up with a complex fraction in our limit as h goes to 0. And the general rule for how to proceed when you end up with a complex fraction is collapse it into a single fraction and then start working with that result. So what we need here is a common denominator, and I'm going to get that done by multiplying my first fraction by g of x over g of x, and my second one by g of x plus h over g of x plus h. That creates a denominator of g of x times g of x plus h, and then we can just subtract straight across. At the same time, we're then going to divide that fraction by h, which just puts an h into its denominator. So again, we multiply the first fraction by g of x over g of x, which gives us a term that looks like f of x plus h times g of x. In our second fraction, we multiply the top and bottom by g of x plus h, and that gives us a term that looks like f of x times g of x plus h. Then the denominator of that fraction is g of x times g of x plus h. And again, we have to divide this whole thing by h, but that's the same as just putting an h into the denominator. So now we have to start playing a game that looks very similar to a trick that we had to come up with when we proved the product rule. What I'm looking for is to recognize the derivative of f or the derivative of g, or perhaps both of those things. And to get the derivative of f, I would have to have f of x plus h minus f of x. And I almost see that, but there's a problem. The second factor that's stuck on these f's is actually different for the two terms. One of them is a g of x and one is a g of x plus h. So what I have to do is just invent a new term that has the correct extra factor on it so that I can factor it out and recognize the derivative of f. Again, what I want is to be able to factor g of x out and end up with an f of x plus h minus f of x, because when I divide that by h and take the limit, it's precisely the definition of f prime. So what I need is a new term up here that looks like minus f of x times g of x. Now, if I factor the g of x out of that, I've got what I need. I've got f of x plus h minus f of x. That looks like the numerator of a difference quotient, and I'm on the right path. But of course, you can't just go around subtracting f of x, g of x from anything you want. You have to compensate for that by adding it back in. So I have a plus f of x, g of x, and then this last term was a spectator, and that's f of x, g of x plus h. And this whole thing is divided by h times g of x plus h. All right, so now if I gather the first two terms in the numerator and factor a g of x out of that, I get the difference I was looking for because I'm trying to build the derivative of f. And notice what happens in our second two terms. The common factor there is f of x. And if I factor that out, I get a difference of two g containing terms, but they're in the wrong order here. So we're gonna have to correct that in just a minute. The positive one is a g of x, and then I have a minus g of x plus h. So in the next step, we'll get the factoring done, and we'll deal with that order issue on the g containing terms. So we're pulling a g of x out of the first two terms, and that leaves us with the difference that we were looking for, f of x plus h minus f of x. And then in our second two terms, I can pull an f of x out of that, but I end up with the g difference being in the wrong order. Well, the way you reverse the direction of a difference is by factoring out a negative 1. So what I'm going to factor out is negative f of x, and that leaves me with a positive g of x plus h term. So I'm going to write that first, and then I have a negative g of x term. And this whole thing is divided by h times g of x times g of x plus h. Now at this point, I think it would honestly be appropriate to just skip ahead of all the remaining algebra, but I do want to highlight exactly what's going on here. So what I want to do is just split things up using the limit laws so that I can explicitly construct the limit as h goes to zero of f of x plus h minus f of x divided by h. In other words, the derivative of f. And I want to do a similar thing for the derivative of g. Again, with a little bit of practice on proofs of this style, you might just want to skip the remaining algebra here because you'll see it from this point. But what I'm going to do is split this fraction into actually two different fractions. So I have this group on the left divided by this denominator minus this group on the right divided by the same denominator. And then I can just take the limits of those separate pieces. Okay, now I use the fact that the limit of a product is just the product of the limits, which means I can split off whatever factors I want from inside of a limit and evaluate that limit separately. So when I do that to my first half of this expression, I end up with a limit as h goes to zero with all the g stuff in it, g of x over g of x times g of x plus h. And I'm not going to cancel the g of x's because it's going to be useful in a second anyway. And then the remaining limit there, and this is the whole point of doing the explicit algebraic manipulation, the remaining limit is exactly the definition of f prime of x. Our second piece will be similar. And so our first piece, I have negative limit as h goes to zero of f of x over these two factors of g. And then I'm left with, again, precisely the definition of the derivative of g. So that limit gives me g prime of x. So now in my very first limit on the left here, I can simply replace the h with a zero and I get g of x over g of x squared. Again, I'm not going to cancel the g's out because I'm going to need a common denominator in a second. Now that second limit of that difference quotient is precisely the definition of f prime. So I have f prime of x. Then in my second term, when I take the limit as h goes to zero of f of x over these two g containing terms, I end up with f of x also over g of x squared. That's going to be my common denominator in just a second. And then the final piece is exactly the definition of g prime of x. So finally, I can multiply these two derivatives into the numerators of their respective fractions. So I'm going to get a g of x f prime of x in the first one, and then minus an f of x g prime of x in the second one. They already have a common denominator built in, so I can go ahead and just do the subtraction straight across and write this as a single fraction. So there's our result for how to differentiate a quotient of two functions in general. And this is a pretty exotic result. So to get the derivative of a quotient of two functions, you have to do all of this stuff involving the original functions and their derivatives in order to find the derivative of their quotient. So I'm going to go ahead and express our new quotient rule using kind of a combination of Leibniz and Newton notations. And there's our next piece in the algebra of differentiation. If you want the derivative of a quotient, you have to take the derivative of the first function multiplied by the second function left alone, subtract from that the first function left alone times the derivative of the second function, and then you divide by that original function that was in the denominator squared. So the cool thing about having this rule now is that it gives us a new class of functions that we can differentiate. Recall up to this point, all we've been differentiating is polynomials. Well, now we can do fractions of polynomials, and those are called rational functions. So let's differentiate this rational function, 3x squared plus 1 divided by 2x minus 3. The quotient rule says that we start this out by taking a term where I have the derivative of the original numerator. And what I'm going to do is just use the prime notation here as a placeholder. As you get more practice, you'll probably just compute these derivatives as you go. But anytime you want to slow things down, you can just leave a prime on there to remind yourself to differentiate that term. So there's the derivative of the numerator times the denominator left alone, and then subtract from that the numerator left alone, that's 3x squared plus 1, times the derivative of the denominator. And again, I'll just leave a little prime on there to remind myself to do it. This is all divided by the original denominator squared. So in the next step, I'm actually going to take these derivatives. So the derivative of 3x squared is just 6x. The derivative of 1 is 0. So I end up with a 6x in this first term, 6x times 2x minus 3. And then in my second term, the 3x squared plus 1 is left alone, and I'm multiplying that by the derivative of 2x minus 3, which is just 2. I then divide everything by 2x minus 3, quantity squared. Now, in general, what you want to do is expand everything in the numerator, combine like terms, and then attempt to factor as far as you possibly can. A lot of these problems in textbooks are rigged for a bunch of common factors to cancel out at the end, but this problem is one I just made up, and that's not likely to happen. But regardless, we just follow this basic procedure, expand, combine like terms, and factor, and then just see what you're left with. So when I distribute this 6x over the 2x minus 3, that leaves me with a 12x squared minus 18x. And then in my second piece, I'm distributing a 2 over a 3x squared plus 1, but then that whole thing is multiplied by negative 1. So I end up with a negative 6x squared and a negative 2. And now we're dividing all this by 2x minus 3 quantity squared. Okay, next we combine like terms in the numerator, and I have a 12x squared minus 6x squared, which leaves me with 6x squared. I have a linear term, negative 18x, and then I have a constant, negative 2. It's all divided by that same old denominator, 2x minus 3 quantity squared. So the last thing we'll do here is just try to factor and cancel common factors. So I have this greatest common factor of 2 that I can pull out of the numerator, and that leaves me with a 3x squared minus 9x minus 1. And in my denominator, I have this 2x minus 3 quantity squared. Well, that quadratic trinomial in the numerator is not going to factor. You can guess and check all you want, but you're not going to end up with the right cross term in there. So that's unfactorable. And the process is basically over. There's no more simplifications I can do. So there's our answer for the derivative of this original rational function. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.